Hello everyone, welcome to another video, this time on orchid flower anatomy. Before I get into it, I just want to let you guys know that I got myself a tripod, so I no longer need to try and film with my chin or try to do one-handed repotting, so that's great. And now you also have more stable footage. It will no longer be as shaky as it was before, hopefully. So the reason I want to talk about the orchid flower anatomy is that often when we buy a new orchid from a florist or from a supermarket, they come without an ID. But still, people will be interested in at least finding an approximate ID match by searching for their orchid online. And to be able to do that, they look at colors and the shape of the flowers, usually. But to be able to actually find the orchid you have, it helps to know some terminology, because half the challenge really is knowing what search terms to use. Knowing some more terminology can also help us describe problems and peculiarities to our fellow growers. For example, instead of saying there's this spot here on this sticky outy thingy and I don't know if it's a mealybug or not, you could more precisely state that there's a spot here on the column of the flower and I'm not sure whether it's a pest or not, or mealybug. It makes life a little bit clearer and easier for everyone involved. So with that introduction out of the way, let's get into a little general orchid flower anatomy. Behold, the Phalaenopsis flower. I wanted to start off with this genus because it's the most widespread one that most people, especially beginners, tend to have. In the center of the flower, you have the column. This is what houses the reproductive organs of the flower. On the tip of the column, you have what is called the anthercap. And as the name suggests, this houses the anthers of the flower. Radiating out around the column, you have the sepals and the petals. Now, the sepals are the ones that you find in the back. They're set in a triangular configuration to each other. And the top one is called the dorsal sepal, while the bottom ones are called the lateral sepals. Set in front of them, also in a triangular configuration, you have the petals. It's 1, 2, 3. Now, the bottom one looks quite different from the rest, and that's because it's actually a modified petal. It is usually referred to as either the lip or the labellum. This is typically where pollinators land when they come to connect the nectar from the flower and pollinate the flower. And the lip here is connected to the column via what they call the throat. And on top of the throat lies the callus. Now, these anatomical parts can be found in most orchid flowers, but they can be hard to recognize in some genera, such as that of the paphiopedilum. The lip of the paphiopedilum is drastically different compared to the lip of the Phalaenopsis, and is often referred to as the pouch instead. The lateral sepals are difficult to identify. In fact, the lateral sepals have fused together to create one large sepal that hides behind the pouch. And the anthercap is absent. In its place, you have a staminode, also known as the shield. But largely, the anatomical parts are still easily identifiable in many of the different genera of orchids. I'll now show you some of the different genera, which I've labeled the different parts, so you can get an idea of how to identify these parts, what they look like in different genera. Alright then, that was all for now. Thank you all for watching. I hope you found it very educational and helpful, and I hope to see you back next time.